Everyone, welcome to the NurdRage Question and Answer Video September Edition. I'm going to do something a bit different this video and show some time-lapse chemical reactions rather than my shockingly handsome mug. Let's see how that works out. Personally, I think looking at chemical reactions is more interesting. First, shout out to the newest big Patreon supporter of NurdRage, Collin Wright. Thank you very much for your contributions, and a special thank you to the supporter who contributed $500 to the YouTube fan funding. Unfortunately, YouTube doesn't give me your name, but thank you very much for your support. You know who you are. Now, before we get to the questions and answers, I'd also like to make big shoutouts to the commercial sponsors for my videos. First is my web developer who makes a smartphone app called Inocidia. With Inocidia, you can get jailbroken things without a jailbreak. So if you're interested in that sort of thing, then check out the website. I've included links in the description. Second is a very important company to me called Alchemy Lab Supply. They sell chemistry glassware. These guys have been incredibly generous to me by replacing the glassware I break, which has been a lot. They have a wide selection of very high-quality research-grade labware at a great price. They're located in Canada, so all you Canadian chemists need affordable labware can get it without getting killed on the foreign exchange rate. As for you American chemists, this deal is still great because right now the American dollar is worth more than the Canadian dollar. One American dollar is worth around $1.33 Canadian, so even with the exchange fees, you're still getting an awesome deal if you're buying labware from these guys. They also claim there will be no import fees, tax, or customs fees when shipping to America. So whoever you are, Canadian or American, please check them out. I've included links in the video description. As for the rest of the world, check them out anyway. You might still find a good deal somewhere. To further sweeten the deal, they're giving a 5% discount if you use the coupon code COPPER. So please, check them out. Okay, moving on to channel business. First, some big news. I have reached my first Patreon goal of $1,000. As promised, I will spin off a second video series where I answer questions and talk about science directly. I'm currently in the process of learning more video composition programs and such to reach that end. I hope to start increasing production in the next several weeks. Don't worry, these videos will not be charged to Patreon. As always, I will only charge for actual, real experiments. I do have one question for you guys, though. Do you want these NurdRage Talk videos on this channel in between the experiments, or do you want me to spin them off in entirely separate channels so you can decide what you'll subscribe to and watch? Let me know in the comments below. So let's get to the questions. There are a lot of them this time, and this will take a while. So, first question, Bryan Boettcher asks, can you talk about the catalytic polymerization of two-part silicone compounds and how they end up so ridiculously tough once cured? Okay, first we need to understand how silicone polymers in general work. In one-part silicone compounds that cure on air, you have monomers of silicon atoms connected to two organic groups and two leaving groups. Usually the organic groups are methyl groups, and the leaving groups can be halides like chlorine or acetate. On air, moisture comes in and reacts with the leaving groups and links together two silicon atoms with an oxygen to form a siloxane. These form very long polymer chains, and that's the cured silicone adhesive. The leaving groups, as their name implies, leave. Now, in two-part silicone compounds, leaving groups are made of very stable compounds like alcohols that don't hydrolyze easily with water. So you can leave them on air, and they would cure extremely slowly. So to make them cure, you add a catalyst that's in the second part of the two-part system that catalyzes the otherwise extremely slow reaction. The catalyst you use depends on the leaving groups you select and can include substances like tin compounds and platinum compounds. As for what makes silicones extremely strong, mix in with the monomers a small amount of silicone that has more than two leaving groups. So when these interlinked with the silicon atoms that have two leaving groups, you get branching. This forms crosslinks between different chains, and it's this crosslinking that gives silicones their strength. I hope that explains it. Okay, next question. Mark Rose asks, what is the chemical process by which Portland cement gets tougher when exposed to water? Okay, Portland cement is a mixture of various minerals that are heated to high temperature and then activated by water and set into the rock-hard cement you're familiar with. Now, in most compositions, a mineral called limestone is included that is composed of calcium carbonate. During the heating process, this calcium loses carbon dioxide and converts to calcium oxide. Now, when you add water later, you turn this calcium oxide into calcium hydroxide that is highly caustic and reacts with the other minerals in the cement. One of the important ones is sand, which is silicon dioxide. When these react, you form a complex mixture of interlocking crystals consisting of sulcates. This is how the cement sets. Interestingly enough, it continues to gain strength as time progresses as carbon dioxide in the air reacts with the calcium hydroxide to form calcium carbonate. So years later, the cement will actually be somewhat stronger than when it was freshly poured. Now, I'm grossly oversimplifying my explanation here, as the other minerals in the cement also play a role, and you can get even more complex mixtures of hydroxides, oxides, carbonates, sulfates, and others. But the calcium carbonate to calcium oxide and hydroxide is the main one. Okay, next question. Collin Wright asks, do you know of any way to deactivate antibiotic molecules like, say, penicillin? Okay, and you're trying to do this for deactivating antibiotics in cattle feed. I don't know. My PhD is in inorganic chemistry, and this is a biochemistry question. But I do suggest you look into antibiotic-resistant bacteria. There are two common ways of being resistant. One, the bacteria simply evolve cellular components that aren't affected by antibiotics. And two, the bacteria evolve enzymes that go out and deactivate antibiotics. So if you can reverse engineer these enzymes, or just coax the bacterium to produce them in mass quantities, you can put that into your cattle feed to deactivate the associated antibiotic. At least that's just my idea. I'm sure an actual biochemist could give you far better answer than mine. Okay, so Jason Black asks, what dictates the amount of energy stored in a chemical explosive, and is there a theoretical maximum limit to that? And how close are the compounds like C4 TNT to that limit? The energy in any chemical reaction, including explosives, is the difference between the potential energy of the reactants and the products. As for the theoretical maximum, that's not an easy question to answer as we start getting into thermodynamics and what state our reactants and products are in. The energy released by a block of frozen TNT when it explodes is actually different from the same amount of TNT being heated close to its decomposition temperature. The thermal capacity of the substance contributes to the energy measured. Even something that has no chemical reactants like helium can have varying amounts of energy depending on the pressure. For example, a tank of super highly compressed helium is an extremely dangerous weapon if you break the valve off, as the energy of the expanding helium will shoot the tank like a torpedo. So a question like, what is the theoretical maximum energy stored in a chemical requires a lot of qualifiers in order to give a consistent answer. In general, though, we chemists consider hydrogen as being the most conventionally energetic chemical. We actually consider TNT not that energetic. In fact, if you look at megajoules per kilogram as your measure of energy at standard temperature and pressure, you find that a bottle of good vodka has more energy than an equivalent mass of TNT. Like even a bad bottle of vodka likely has more energy. What makes TNT seem very powerful is that it releases energy all at once in an explosion, while a bottle of vodka releases its energy very slowly to metabolize it. But if you could incorporate vodka into a thermobaric weapon, it would theoretically have greater energy content. I'm sorry that I didn't actually answer your question, just the question requires a lot more qualification to do so. Okay, next question. Chris Piper asks, water is always used as a reference for viscosity, and are there any substances that are appreciably less viscous than water? Okay. Yeah, a lot of organic solvents like alcohol or dichloromethane have lower viscosities. Keep in mind, temperature and pressure play a factor as well. Personally, back when I was working with fluorocarbon gases, I compressed some in clear glass storage vessels, and when they liquefied, the fluids appeared to have very low viscosities when I shook them. So inert gases at room temperature that are pressurized to the point of being liquids might have the properties you're looking for. But compressed gas in clear glass vessels are extremely dangerous, because glass is fragile. So don't actually do this without training in the appropriate safety measures for working with explosion hazards. Okay, next question. Keith asks, let's see now, what was this answer on his test? And how do you regenerate it? Okay, I generally don't do homework for people. Although it does sound like you have an ion exchange material, these are usually regenerated by soaking them in concentrated sodium chloride solution. The ion exchange is out to make calcium chloride, and you just wash it out. As for the identity of your material, it does sound like a zeolite if it's a metal cage. So, yeah. Okay, next question. ChaosR1024 asks, let's see now. Basically, how to obtain or get nitrates. Well, if you have absolutely no source of nitrates, then there are only two ways I know of for making them directly. One is the Birkeland-Ide reactor that passes an electric arc through air to make nitrogen oxides, and the Ostwald process, which essentially burns ammonia over catalysts, do the same thing. The problem with the Birkeland-Ide reactor is that it uses a lot of electrical power, which I hear is not a cheap thing in the European Union. The Ostwald process requires the construction of a gas reactor and uses a platinum catalyst. Platinum is not a cheap thing to get anywhere. I'll see if I can make a video on these processes, or if I can find an alternative process, but I make no promises. Okay, next question. Sajit Anima asks, basically asking for thesis suggestions and something along the lines of physics and chemistry. Okay, both chemistry and physics. Research the properties of positronium? How about superconductors? Radiation detectors, like liquid scintillation counting? If you want something a bit simpler, maybe magnetic materials, nanoparticles, or Mossbauer spectroscopy? Yeah, I have no idea. Okay, moving on to next question. Gabriel Gentilio asks, at the end of your Make Purified Clopotenic Acid video, you said it's a precursor to useful compounds you'd make in another video, while showing large red crystals in a vial. Well, did that come out, and what was the compound? Okay. So you're probably referring to this image I showed. Those beautiful red crystals are potassium tetrachloroplatinate. Well, I did film the process of making them. The problem was the film sucked. Bad camera angles, a very clunky procedure, and excessive on-the-fly changes to the procedure made for a video that was downright awful to watch. I want to redo the procedure, but the platinum compounds had been earmarked for other uses, so I put the video on hold. Eventually, I finished my research at that lab and left before more platinum came in. So until I can purchase my own platinum bar or find alternative source of platinum, it may be a very long time before I have another shot at it. And even then, being as expensive as it is, I am going to have to be very careful before spending valuable Patreon funds. So I have to make absolutely sure I get it right. There are no retries if I mess it up. So it might be some time. We'll see what happens in the future. Okay, moving on. So, Cullen Purkis asks, let's see now. Can you please explain how to determine the concentration of ammonia solution from the percentage of ammonia or mass of the solution? Okay, let's see now. Well, the really simple, straightforward to do is not really to do it. There are online tables that relate the concentration to other variables like percentage by mass. It's very easy to Google them online. It's very hard to break the concentrations because the volumes of two chemicals is not always as simple as adding them together. Sometimes they are over under depending on how they interact. So the concentration versus percentage mass is usually found empirically and then recorded on tables for future reference. Now actually measuring it is fairly straightforward if a bit tedious. You just get some pure water of known mass and volume, bubble in some ammonia, and then measure its new volume and mass. From there you know how much ammonia is in solution and can easily calculate and record the percentage of mass and concentration. Okay, next question. Gustav Ortenberg asks, thoughts and opinions on the topic of nuclear energy, specifically liquid fluoride thorium reactors. That's the problem with writing out acronyms and then saying what it is afterward. Okay, personally, I am a very strong supporter of nuclear energy. If used responsibly and intelligently, it can do tremendous good. Modern nuclear reactor designs, like the liquid fluoride thorium reactor you mentioned, are inherently safe, even to catastrophic disasters. So I would love to see more nuclear power generation being brought online with modern systems. That being said, I do understand there are some obstacles, mostly public opinions and politics. People have greater fear of things that kill them quickly and horrifically, even though they are rare, than things that kill them slowly and silently but are more prevalent. This is why people fear airplanes more than cars, even though cars kill far more people. Now, I can go on and on about my opinions about human psyche, but you don't want to hear me rant, you want chemistry, so let's get back to that. Next question. Pavel Kurkovsky asks, would you be willing to do a video or several on uranium chemistry? No. For the simple reason in that it's actually kind of boring. There are some nice colors with uranium, and uranium glass has beautiful fluorescence, but that's about it. There's not much to be done with uranium in the lab that would make a good video. Now, if my Patreon supporters petition me to do it, then I'll consider it, but I honestly don't think uranium chemistry is fascinating enough for a video. Okay, Mark Wenis asks, let's see now, pretty much asking, could I make more videos on isolating elements? I do intend to have more videos on isolating elements. It just takes a lot of time in between the other videos I do, but I'll see what I can do. Okay, so moving on. Nolan Wilson asks, have you ever worked with hydride salts, and a video detailing other preparation would be very interesting. Yeah, I've worked with a few, sodium hydride and lithium aluminum hydride. I'll see what I can do about the videos. Let's see, okay, next question. Roland Henry asks, what would be the cheapest and easiest way to freeze-dry food at home? Okay, let's see. The hardest part of a freeze dryer is to maintain good vacuum. You need a powerful vacuum pump that can go below the triple point pressure of water, and it needs to run continuously throughout the freeze drying process. Then there is the cost of the freezer that needs to be exceptionally cold and controllable. These two things can be quite expensive. I don't know the way to do it easier and cheaper, and having done lots of work under vacuum and cryogenic conditions, I know just how hard it is. I don't trust claims online of simple freezer hacks. I guess my simple answer for you is I don't know. That's more of a mechanical engineering problem than a chemistry one. Okay, next question. Andrew Wright asks, when did you come to the conclusion that you wanted to be a chemist? Okay, when I was deciding what major to pick for university, I had a choice between software engineering or chemistry, and I made the wrong choice. Okay, next question. Nani Mouse asks, are you afraid bad people will do bad things with your videos? Yeah, well, okay. Yeah, I suppose that's somewhat of a concern. I don't want people doing bad things with my videos. That being said, I'm not going to stop because I don't think keeping people stupid makes them safer. And I, for one, will not allow the actions of a few murderers, extremists, and maniacs to coerce me into suppressing the education and inspiration of the next generation of doctors, scientists, and engineers. And I think that we as scientists and educators and whatever should just try and educate as much as possible so that we have far more good people than we have bad people. So yeah, to answer your question, yes, I am afraid of bad people doing bad things, but I'm more afraid of good people not doing good things. So I'm going to continue giving them the tools and the knowledge and the inspiration to do good things. Okay, so yeah, I guess that's it for that video. That was a pretty long one. I shall see you next month or on another channel if you decide, if that's what you guys decide on the comments. Okay, take care, y'all.